Excuse me, ladies and gentlemen. If I could have your attention, I have an announcement to make. I'm the Gene Culpepper, the director of tonight's show. Thank you. So, the circumstances surrounding tonight's show are a little unusual. I was, of course, flattered when Billy St. John, who wrote Murders in the Air, you might have noticed in your program, Heir is spelled H-E-I-R, Murders in the Air. Get it? Yes? Yeah. So, anyway, I was, of course, flattered when Mr. St. John asked me to direct the play's premiere production, but actually, it was a bit of a work in progress. He continued to make changes and rewrites throughout the rehearsal period. And, well, while it's gratifying to be part of the creative process of a brand new work, frankly, put quite a strain on me. And the playwriting cast, of course, too. Hush, Caleb. Actors should be unseen and unheard until the curtain opens. Sorry about that. The cast and I were a little nervous, you see. Well, frankly, the show's not quite finished. Don't worry, the show will go on. Show must go on, as someone once said. Strangle them. Anyway, the thing is, the show isn't quite finished, you see. It's a murder mystery, and, well, most of the cast have excellent reason to kill, well, you'll see who. And the thing is that Mr. St. John couldn't make up his mind about who the murderer should be. He wrote multiple endings in which the various characters were determined to be the murderer, and we performed them all for him, but he still couldn't make up his mind. As it got closer and closer to opening night, the tension in the air, that's A-I-R, grew so thick, you could cut it with a knife. It got so bad that Mr. St. John had what I'm sure will prove to be a temporary breakdown. But, that's why he's not here tonight. He's currently under heavy sedation. A very nice place with soft walls and heavy padding. Some folks have all the luck. Anyway, the cast and crew and I are here, though, and determined to put on an entertaining show for you, even if it kills us. That's just a figure of speech, of course. That does bring us to the main reason why I'm out here tonight. Now, it's to let you know that, well, frankly, we need your help. If you look in your programs, there's a loose slip of paper, a ballot of sorts. And as you watch the first act, you'll see who the suspects would be who might have killed someone, a person who will indeed be very dead by the end of the first act. During intermission, we need you to fill out that ballot and indicate who you think is most likely the murderer. We'll gather them and tally them quickly, and for the second act, this cast will perform the scenes that Mr. St. John wrote, in which the character the majority of you selected is the murderer. At least, that's what we hope will happen. Got a little confusing during rehearsals.
It's a wonder we didn't kill the playwright. Get off the stage already!
Quiet! Listen, sorry about that. I saved myself a seat down front, and I'll follow along in the script. Help out if things get a little shaky, which they won't, but just in case. Anyway, are you ready, cast?
As ready as we're gonna be.
Okay, well, I guess let's do this. Places! Lights!
Shock to a man in his 90s and Mr. Starkweather's medical condition could prove fatal. Remember that, girl.
Well, I will, Miss Withers. I guess this storm has got me a little edgy.
Yes, it is a tempestuous evening, isn't it? I presume all the guests have been shown to their rooms?
Well, yes. All but Mr. Starkweather's grandson, Simon III. It's a long drive from his college, and with this storm. Well, you know.
Well, I hope we can start without him. It's already past Mr. Starkweather's bedtime, and he must have his sleep.
I assure you, Miss Withers, the room is spotlessly clean.
Well, I certainly hope so. Mr. Starkweather's asthmatic conditions makes the merest mote of dust potentially lethal.
I served as Mr. Starkweather's housekeeper for many years before you came here, Miss Withers. I don't need you to tell me how to do my job. You brought the coffee.
Why, yes, it's right here on the table, Miss Trent.
Then go back to the kitchen and help Minerva with the rest of the refreshments.
Yes, ma'am.
Mr. Starkweather gave specific instructions that he wishes to have everyone present in the drawing room at 8 o'clock, sharp. I'll ask Bensonhurst to fetch the guests from their rooms.
Mr. Starkweather, we ready? I'm coming, Mr. Starkweather!
I done got all the cars parked in the garages, like you told me to, Mr. Bensonhurst.
Rufus. It's as I... Why waste my breath? Rufus, you're dripping water all over the floor. Rufus, why did you come into the front door? I've told you a million times that servants never use the front door.
Well, I reckon I forgot, Mr. Bensonhurst. Besides, it's raining out there.
Well, yes, I know that. And now it appears as though it's been raining in here, thanks to you.
Well, you're welcome.
Just go back out the way you came and maneuver yourself around to the back door. You think you can manage that?
Well, I don't know, but I suppose we're both going to find out.
Just wait until I call for you to park the final guest, young Master Simon III's car.
Oh, good. Well, while I'm waiting, I'm going to sit by that fire and see if I can grow some gills for that rain. You know what I'm saying?
Rufus, just go to the kitchen and wait till I call for you.
Yes, sir.
That man's an idiot.
Hey, I can hear that.
Place them on coffee table. Carefully, this time.
Well, I think everything's all right already.
Oh, you think, eh? Well, you think wrong. Come here, come. You see this? This! You need to place the cups on the mini plates like this. That's what I will have to do is pour coffee.
All right.
All right, now fix your mistake.
Miss, yes, the others are coming down. Miss Van Zandt informed me that he wishes the servants to be present.
Ugh, he wants the servants in here?
Precisely.
Even Rufus.
If I had known of the facts sooner, I would have ordered him to take a bath. Though, he has been on the rain parking cars. Perhaps that will have helped.
Ha! If you ask me, not even Noah's flat would help him.
Be that as it may, I shall inform him and Miss Trent.
Minerva, why would Mr. Starkweather want the servants to be here?
Oh, I'll just pull out my crystal ball and let you know. Nancy, do you remember what I told you when you first came to work here?
Well, yes. Do as you're told and don't ask questions.
Exactly. Stick to that.
I will.
Good.
Oh, dear. I never know what to wear on special occasions. Well, I suppose Simon inviting us here is a special occasion, isn't it, Jordan?
Well, I suppose so, if you consider that most of the time he treats us like lepers.
Oh, you think Simon treats us like jungle cats?
Not leopards, Mother. Lepers. Oh, forget it. And don't worry, Mother. You look fine.
Oh, thank you, son.
I'll tell you one thing. If we should ever inherit this mausoleum, the first thing we'll do is call up the Adams family and let them know it's on the market.
Ah, yes. I see we are counting the chickens already, are we?
Minerva, we didn't see you and your attractive young helper there.
Oh, no. No, 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 no. Nancy's a good girl, Jordan. And I mean for this one to stay that way.
Well, I'm sure I don't know what you mean.
I doubt that.
I don't understand.
I believe that. Miss Fiona, why don't you have a seat? We will bring you a cup of coffee. How do you take your coffee, ma'am?
Well, Mother prefers hers black, but I like mine sweet. I'll flavor it myself.
Bezrat Snitsi.
Oh, what lovely hors d'oeuvres. Mmm, these look delicious.
I'm glad you like them, ma'am. They are a good grandmama's recipe.
You're looking very pretty tonight, Nancy.
Well, thank you, sir.
Sir? That makes me feel as old as my great uncle Simon. Please, call me Jordan.
She will call you Mr. Starkweather, the way a proper maid should. If anyone calls you by another name, it will be me. And you don't want to know which one I'm thinking of.
Oh, Minerva, you never change.
Neither do you. More's the pity. Now go have a seat next to your mother.
And living out here in the boonies, away from fine restaurants and shopping centers and movie theaters. Why, I'd get so depressed, I'd just sit down and weep.
Oh, Paula, it's not that bad. I stay here during the week and go back to my apartment in town most weekends.
Oh, I'm so relieved to hear that.
Yeah, I worked for a really large corporation before Mr. Starkweather hired me as his personal secretary, and believe me, this position is much nicer. That other place was a dump.
Mother, look what we have here. Two rays of sunshine to dispel the gloom. You look beautiful, ladies.
Cousin Jordan, you're a rogue and a charmer.
I do my best. Won't you join us?
Have a seat over here, ladies. You'll be safer. We will bring you a cup of coffee, yes?
Thanks, Minerva. I take mine black.
Load mine down with lots of cream and sugar. Sugar. I must admit, I have an enormous sweet tooth.
Oh, yes. That must be what causes that, corn syrup accent, right?
Fiona, how are you this evening?
What?
Fiona, over here.
Oh, hi, Paula. I'm lovely, thank you.
Well, that's just peachy. I swear, I don't know why we don't see more of one another.
Oh, mm-hmm.
Seems like the only time we get together is for somebody's funeral.
Well, aren't all funerals for some body?
Don't be morbid. I'm glad this weekend's an exception to the rule. For once, no one's dead.
So far, anyway.
Oh, don't worry, honey, didn't spill any.
What did you mean by that remark, Jordan?
Oh, nothing. It's just, at first when you called to say that Great Uncle Simon wanted Mother and me to come up and visit Starkweather Mansion for the weekend, I assumed you were going to say that the old man had passed on.
You wish.
Yes, I even started to pack my new black dress, you know the one?
Yeah, I do. It was a natural assumption. The old man is up in years and in bad health, much like my mother here. I was relieved to find out that the old boy was still with us.
Kathy, darling, I bet you know why Great Uncle Simon desired our presence on this frightful evening. Come on, tell.
Well, Miss Van Zant will go into the particulars later, but I believe Mr. Starkweather wishes to discuss his new will.
Really?
Jordan! I would appreciate it if you didn't drool all over my hors d'oeuvres.
Why, you misjudge me, Minerva. I was surprised. That's all.
You'll wear him.
Well, where's Cousin Simon? Shouldn't he be here too?
When I contacted him last week, he said he could make it. But if he's tried to call tonight, he can't get through because the phone lines are down.
Well, I'm just saying, if I were to talk about my will, I would want my only grandchild to be here.
Yeah, and Simon will probably get everything.
Excuse me. Sorry, you guys are doing great. Really?
Really? Really?
Folks, I thought the family relationships might be a little confusing, and I suggested to Mr. John something about that, and he agreed and was working on that when he snapped like a rubber band. Anyway, I'll just tell you. I believe the information's on the screen behind me as well. So, here goes. Simon Starkweather, the old billionaire, married late in life and had a son, Simon Jr., who married and in turn had a son, Simon III, a college student who's late for the gathering. And old Simon's elder brother, Paul, had a daughter, Bella, married Lucian Thompson, an Atlanta businessman. They had Paula here. Unfortunately, see here, the original Mrs. Stockwell is dead. Simon Jr., his wife, Lucian, Bella, Paul, his wife. Anyway, old Simon's younger brother, John, then married and had a son, Ezra, who married Fiona here. And they had a son, Jordan. This is Jordan, but you know all that. Anyway. So, John, his wife, Ezra, are unfortunately dead, too. Now, I realize that's a lot of dead people, but frankly, if we cast them all, it would look like a marching band was walking through the living room.
That's true. Yeah.
Believe me, it was difficult enough to get all of them on stage as it was. Anyway, so old Simon is, he's Fiona's uncle, and Jordan and Paula's great-uncle, and that makes Simon III and Jordan and Paula cousins of a sort. Okay. Second, third cousins or something. I don't really know how that goes. But anyway, I hope that clears things up for you. Carry on.
Thanks. Gladly.
We haven't the foggiest idea where we are.
Really, Duncan? Yeah, I don't even know who I am.
Sorry. Resume with Blake and Naomi's entrance. Duncan.
Yeah.
Give them their entrance cue.
What is it?
He'll probably get everything.
Who will?
Cousin Simon?
Oh. Okay. Yeah, and he'll probably get everything.
I've been very pleased with your investigation, Mr. Davis. I'll be glad to recommend you to my other client.
Just doing my job, Miss Van Zandt.
Good evening, everyone.
I know we haven't met yet, but I've got a pretty good idea of who you all are. Mrs. Starkweather and her son Jordan, right?
That's right, Mr.
Davis. Call me Mike.
I see. Now, from what Miss Van Zandt just said, I assume you must be some sort of investigator.
You got it, pal. The private kind.
I see.
Jordan, who is this nice young man here?
He's a detective, Mother.
A detective? How exciting! Do you know Jessica Fletcher?
I'm afraid she's way out of my league. Oh. I do know who you two ladies must be, though.
Well, if you're a private investigator, be surprised if you didn't.
That accent settles it. You're Paula Thompson.
You are 100% correct. I can't deny I'm from the Deep South.
If she came from any deeper south, she'd live in Central America.
That leaves you to be Kathy Collins. It's nice to finally meet you in person.
It's nice to finally meet you too, Mike. Mike and I have corresponded for some time on Mr. Starkweather's behalf.
Is a seat taken? I'll sit here.
And
I expect you to remain unobtrusive.
Well, I sure will, Mr. Bensonhurst. Just as soon as I find a dictionary and look up that big old word. Y'all got a dictionary?
Just go over there and sit by the fire.
Glad to. My backside is still kind of soggy.
Bookface!
Keep an eye on him.
If all is in readiness, Miss Van Zandt, I shall inform Mr. Starkweather.
Yes, thank you, Bensonhurst. There is coffee if anybody else would like some.
I could use some in a bit.
How do you take it?
In a cup? Am I right, my man? In a cup?
Black, please.
Keep still. Miss Van Zandt, I believe Great Uncle Simon has called us here to talk about his will.
That is correct. Frankly, I didn't think it was a good idea. Mr. Starkweather's health has been precarious at best, and he could do without the excitement. But he insisted upon summoning you to Starkweather Mansion. I only hope he doesn't live to regret that decision.
Miss Withers will be bringing in Mr. Starkweather now.
Can I move, Mr. Bensonhurst?
No.
Here you are, Mr. Starkweather.
Go!
I'll be right back here if you need me.
To think, I was once surrounded by presidents and kings. Now look, is this all I have left? A handful of relatives and a meager staff of hired help? Simon, where's my grandson?
We presume he's on his way, Mr. Starkweather.
Oh, man. No, it's too late. Can't wait for him anymore.
Well, good evening, Great Uncle Simon. You're looking well.
Are you blind, boy, or just a habitual liar?
I was just making pleasantries, Uncle.
Save your breath. You're nothing but a smooth talker, Jordan, and that doesn't cut any ice with me. You've always... What was I saying? I've lost my thought.
Whatever. You're an old man, Uncle.
Well, you're looking the same.
Oh, thank you, Uncle Simon.
T'wasn't necessarily meant as a compliment.
You're awful.
At my age and with my money, I can afford to say exactly what I think and I do. Now, how's my little Georgia peach?
Little old me. Well, I'm just peachy, Uncle. It may barf. Mr. Starkweather, would you care for a cup of coffee?
No, Minerva. How many times do I have to tell you he can't have any? The caffeine would keep him awake, and it could affect his blood pressure. You know that sometimes his medications cause it to run a little high.
Apparently, I won't be having any. You heard my keeper.
Yes, sir!
Everyone aspires to live to a ripe old age. And for what? To be kept alive by medicines and machines? To be kept from enjoying so much of life's simplest pleasures, even ones as insignificant as a small cup of coffee?
You mustn't excite yourself, Mr. Starkweather. Your blood pressure.
You see, I'm not even allowed to feel any strong emotions.
Well, that's a bummer. Truly is. It is.
You put it succinctly, Rufus. Old age is a bummer. I could have searched my vocabulary extensively and never found a word quite as apt as bummer.
Well, I'm glad you like it. You can keep it.
Oh.
Fortunately, according to my doctors, I won't have to remain a prisoner in this body much longer. There's only one thing I hate to leave behind. My money.
Well, you know what they say, Uncle? You can't take it with you. And exactly how much can you not take with you?
Yes, they do say that. So I have Lois here draw up my will several years back. I suppose you'd like to know how I provided for you, my heirs.
Oh, well, I, for one, must admit, I'm just a teensy bit curious.
A teensy bit, eh?
I knew this was gonna happen. Here, Mrs. Starkweather, breathe deeply. Do you see what you've done to him?
Should somebody call an ambulance?
Not to be a bummer, but we can't because the phone lines are down.
Who's that?
Oh, calm down. He just lost his breath. He just needs to breathe pure oxygen for a few minutes.
Tell them.
Very well. This is the will that Mr. Starkweather was referring to. As you know, for many years, he's been a tremendously successful businessman.
I'll say, he's been on the cover of Forbes magazine at least a dozen times.
Well, I never read that.
It helps if you can read.
Ouch, that hurt.
He has the distinction of becoming one of the world's first billionaires.
Oh, you know, one time I was advising Ezra to ask his Uncle Simon for advice on business investments. Oh, but he was too proud.
Yes, Dad had his pride. Lots of pride and very little money.
If I may continue, Mr. Starkweather's fortune is now in the neighborhood of $50
billion. $50 billion?
If I'd have known that, I think I'd have asked for a raise.
Now, I won't go into the details of the will, but it essentially bequeaths $1 million to each of his household staff. They are Mrs. Trent, his housekeeper, Mr. Bensonhurst, his butler, Miss Minerva, his cook, Miss Withers, his nurse, Miss Nancy, his maid, and Rufus, his handyman.
Well, forget the raise! Man, that's
what? I have no idea.
You're insufferable.
The rest of the money is to be divided equally among his surviving relatives. They are Simon III, his grandson, his niece Fiona and her son Jordan, who will share 1/3, and his great-niece Paula Thompson.
Well, I always knew you would do right by us, Uncle.
I know you got mad when Mama married a Southern boy, but you two must have agreed on one thing. Blood is thicker than water.
Oh, ma'am, I bet Miss Withers could tell you if it is. She knows that kind of stuff. Yes, she does. Yes, she does.
Now that I've informed you as to the will's contents, I have another announcement to make. As of tomorrow, this will becomes invalid.
What?
Wait a minute. What does invalid even mean?
Means no good.
No good, huh? Well, I think I got me a brother that's invalid. You know what I'm saying?
All right. What Miss Van Zandt means is we won't be getting any of the money, you fools.
Really? Well, I guess I won't be getting that big old screen TV I was thinking about. Sit.
Why did you decide to disinherit us, Uncle?
Found a better use for my money, that's why. Oh, but I haven't disinherited you entirely. Every one of you that was in the old will be getting $50,000 each.
$50,000? Mom, out of 50 billion?
Lois here advised me it would be a good idea to leave you all a little something. That way you'd be less likely to be able to contest my new will.
Will?
Exactly. That's why I had Kathy here stay over for the weekend, to type it up nice and legal for my signature. Mr. Davis, as a disinterested party, will witness the signing, and Lois will file it into the courthouse come Monday.
Well, Mr. Davis said he was a detective. What exactly did you hire him to do?
Mr. Starkweather hired me to conduct an investigation on the quiet. For the last 6 months, I have flown to a dozen or more foreign countries, checking out some of the world's most brilliant scientists. Some well-known, and others who prefer to keep their experiments hush-hush. I succeeded in finding one in Belgium. Let's call him Dr. X, who agreed to help Mr. Starkweather do what he desires, which is to clone himself.
What? That's insane!
What nonsense!
Girl, I don't understand.
Good. For once, I'm not the only one. Thank you.
Those blood and skin samples you had me prepare? The ones that you said would be examined by specialists?
They were sent to specialists. Specialists in DNA.
I thought you were trying to find a cure.
I was. Not a cure for my various ailments, but a cure for death itself. And I found it.
Cloning?
Precisely. Through modern science, I shall live forever.
That's not right.
Let the moralists and the politicians debate that issue for decades to come. Meanwhile, Dr. X, as Mr. Davis has named him, will be creating a brand new me. You know, a lot of you seem displeased. Not, I suspect, by the moral question, but rather in your change in fortune. Well, too bad. Cloning is very expensive, and mine has to be done in absolute secrecy. Fortunately, I will still have a sizable fortune for the new me to inherit. No doubt, I will become the first person on Earth to become my own heir. My blood pressure.
Yes. You'll all excuse me. I have to go take Mr. Stark with his blood pressure.
Withers, stop it. Why don't you just take his blood pressure right here?
Because, Paula, his arms are too frail for me to get a reading from them. This is an outsized cuff made to go around a patient's thigh. You can stand the pressure from the cuff better there. Mr. Starkweather has had enough excitement for one evening. Get out of my way!
I guess this concludes our meeting, unless anyone has any questions?
I do. Yeah, I got a question. What the heck was that all about?
It's simple, Rufus. Great Uncle Simon was going to leave us all a fortune. But he's changed his mind. Instead, he's decided to clone himself.
What does clone even mean?
It means to take some cells from a person's body and create a duplicate of the original.
Well, they can do that? Well, that's great. Maybe I can get a job working for the new Mr. Starkweather.
Not
handyman.
That's not how it works. The new Mr. Starkweather will have to be born and grow up. It goes against the laws of nature. How?
It's all been arranged. Once Dr. X has created the new life, the cells will be implanted into a host mother who will carry the child to term.
Host mother? Who?
Me. What? What?
Well, that's disgusting.
Why not? I'm young and healthy and beautiful. I'll make a great mother for little Simon.
How could you ever consider being a part of this travesty?
I'll be well compensated. Plus, do you know anyone else to birth a baby billionaire?
Giving
his money to a baby?
In general speaking, yes. The new will places the fortune into a trust fund, which I'll administer. I'll release the funds to pay Dr. X and his staff for performing the procedure. After that, there shall be ample funds to provide for Kathy's care and little Simon's upbringing and education. After he's grown and trained to deal in high finance, the estate will be turned over to him.
The kid will look, think, and act like Simon Starkweather. He could conceivably parlay those billions into trillions by the time he's an old man.
But for what purpose? To leave it to another clone and another and another? When will it end? When there's a Simon Starkweather with enough money and power to rule the world?
We didn't discuss it, but you may well be right.
How could you condone such madness?
Oh, even I can see why they would. Miss Van Zandt and Nicolin's girl will live like billionaires off Mr. Starkweather's money. Money that should have gone to us and his family. And I suppose you only get rich too out of this crazy scheme.
Not me. I did the job I was paid to do. My part is over. I'll take my check and go home. Because quite frankly, I don't care if this sci-fi experiment works or not.
You should be ashamed. You should all be ashamed. Every last one of you!
Ladies, I believe you've made your feelings quite clear.
Not clear enough.
If the servants would like to join me in the kitchen, I'd like to have a word. We'll clear up after you're finished. I trust you'll ring if you require anything else.
Yes, thank you.
Might be kind of nice, I suppose, hearing a little pitter-patter of feet around the house again.
Oh, shut up, Rufus! Come!
Kathy and I will retire to my room. I'll instruct you on how to put the new will into the proper legal terms for Mr. Starkweather's signature.
Sure, Lois. The sooner it's finished and signed, the better.
Stop it. How come nobody asked me if I wanted to carry the baby? I could do it just as well as she can. You're Mr. Starkweather's blood kin, Paula. It simply wouldn't be proper.
I guess it would be kind of tacky.
Yeah.
Hold on a minute. Proper? You're worried about being proper? You two are about to conduct an experiment that makes Frankenstein look like an amateur, and you two are worried about being proper?
Cool it, kid, before you burst a blood vessel. Mr. Starkweather's already made up his mind, and I've got a feeling that whatever the old man wants, he gets.
Succinctly put, Mr. Davis.
Kathy, excuse us.
I'll go upstairs and pack. After I witness the signing of the new will tomorrow, I won't have any reason to hang around. Good night.
We were robbed.
Oh, we were?
Yes, Mother.
Oh, no.
Great Uncle Simon dangled a fortune right in front of our noses and then snatched it away.
Yeah, that was mean.
Mean? The man's a monster. Didn't you see the evil glint in his eye as he pulled the rug right out from under our feet?
At least, he's leaving us 50,000.
To him, that's no more than tossing a dime to a beggar. And you heard him. He's just doing it so we won't break the new will.
Yeah.
You know what? I wish you were dead. I wish that the old goat would drop dead tonight.
It would serve him right.
If Simon did die tonight, we would all get our monies. Wouldn't we, my dears? Would anyone like to play bridge? Would you like to play bridge with me, Jordan? Bridge? Bridge?
Penny for your thoughts. That's all I can afford to pay now.
Oh, Mr. Starkweather.
It's Jordan, remember? At least when that dragon lady Minerva isn't around.
I thought everyone had gone to bed.
Well, I was going to turn in, but I got the urge for a midnight snack.
Huh? Well, I'll fix you something.
Never mind. What are you doing up?
Oh, well, Miss Trent sent me in here to check on the fire screen and make sure that it was properly closed, so that no sparks pop out onto the rug.
And burn Starkweather Mansion to the ground? Well, maybe that wouldn't be such a bad idea.
Mr. Starkweather is an invalid. How could you say such a thing?
Well, Nancy, why should that surprise you? Everyone knows that I'm the black sheep of the family. If it were to happen tonight, well, just think about it, Nancy. You'd have $1 million, and I'd have billions. Think times that we could have together. I don't want to set this house on fire. I just want to start a flame in your heart.
Don't!
It's a tempting thought. Admit it.
It's not. It's a horrible idea.
Well, which part? The part about the money? Or you and me together? I've got you,
Nancy! What are you doing in here? I thought you were going to help me with the dishes.
Oh. What was I doing? Oh. Well?
Oh, Miss Trent sent me in here to check on the fire screen and make sure it was properly closed so that no sparks pop out onto the rug and, you know, burn Starkweather Mansion to the ground.
I guess you are doing your job then.
Wait!
I haven't forgotten about you. What are you doing in here?
I was hungry for a little snack, so I came down and I saw Nancy and stopped for a little chat.
Yes, a little chat.
That appetite of yours is going to get you in trouble one of these days.
Minerva, what are you doing with that knife?
This whole thing. Well, I was just going to mince an onion. I tend to chop things when I'm thinking or when I'm angry.
But at midnight.
Well, I don't need to explain myself to you. But if you must know, I don't like people seeing me cry, okay? I thought I heard the noise in here and came to check. I'm glad I did. Well, Jordan, if you're hungry, come with me. I'm sure I can find something for your ego.
Yes, Minerva. Anything you say, Minerva.
Good. Now you, finish checking, and then come give me a hand.
Okay.
Good. Nuzhe!
Rufus!
It was just me.
Yes, it is, isn't it?
Good grief, man! What are you doing with that axe?
It's like this. I remember chopping wood for the fire this afternoon before it started raining, but I forgot to put the axe back in the shed. I've been disremembering a lot of things here lately. When it come to me, where I'd left her, I figured I'd better bring her inside and dry her off so it don't rust.
Well, that's not a bad idea. But why did you bring it into the living room? If Mr. Starkweather saw that, he could have a heart attack. Besides,
How many times do I have to tell you to use the back door?
Oh, as many times as you want, Mr. Bensonhurst. I do not keep track of that kind of stuff. No, sir.
I swear, Rufus, you'll be the death of me yet. Go to the kitchen and have Miss Trent fetch you a towel.
Well, what for, Mr. Bensonhurst? I'm wet. It quit raining.
Yes, Rufus, it's not for you. It's for the axe.
Ooh, you're good. You're real good.
Oh, if that man had a brain, he'd be dangerous.
Mr. Bensonhurst, I'm right at the couch.
Penny, for your thoughts.
Jordan! What are you doing up so late?
Munchies. Want a cookie?
No, thanks. I only eat avocado toast and crackers.
So, have you and Miss Van Zandt finished typing up that new will?
It's all finished and ready. It just needs Mr. Starkweather's signature. I'm sure you calmed down about the whole thing. I wouldn't blame you if you hated me.
Kathy, hate you? Why should I hate you? I'd make the same deal if I were in your shoes.
I'm sure you would, Jordan.
You know, Minerva was right. Raising the little tyke will be the next best thing to owning the billions yourself. You're forgetting something, though.
What could I be forgetting?
Well, little tyke will need a dad. Someone to mold him and raise him into the perfect replica of Great Uncle Simon. A cold, heartless, handsome, if you look at him right. Money-making machine.
You think so?
I know so. And who would make a better father figure than I? You're a very attractive woman, Kathy, and we can mix business with pleasure.
Get your filthy paws off my silky blouse!
What?
You heard me. You're getting cookie crumbs all over my blouse. And by the way, forget it. If I decide little Simon needs a father, I'll find a suitable one then. But it won't be some slime ball, money-hungry man like you, Jordan Starkweather.
I could kill you. You witch.
I wouldn't try it if I were you. Not with a detective in the house.
Aren't you finished in here yet?
Well, almost. There's something that I need to do.
Well, hurry up. Minerva wants you in the kitchen.
Yes.
Don't dawdle. Someone let the French doors open again. Miss Thompson?
Ah! Miss Trent. You gave me a fright.
I suppose I should be grateful you didn't shoot me. What on earth are you doing in the middle of the night roaming the house with a gun in your hand?
Don't worry. I know how to handle a gun. I couldn't sleep, though I thought I'd clean it. My beautiful golden shiny gun was looking a little dingy. So I was going to look for some oil.
I doubt you'll find what you need in there unless you want to rub it with Crisco. Do you often carry that around with you?
I take it everywhere I go. My daddy taught me to be a crack shot when I was 10. Girl can't be too careful.
No, I guess you can't. but we're miles away from the nearest town and no one comes this way.
You never had a burglary or a prowler?
No.
I'm just saying, since the French doors are right over here, it'd be easy for somebody just step on in. Tiptoed his room. And do who knows what to him.
Like shoot him?
As terrible as the thought is. In his condition, how could he defend himself?
He could sick Nurse Withers on them, I suppose. That would frighten away any intruders.
You're awful. But you know what? I wouldn't want to tangle with the woman. Where does she sleep?
In the room beyond Mr. Starkweather's, so she can hear him if he rings the bell for her in the middle of the night.
Let's see, if I remember correctly, Mama brought me here when I was still a little, tiny little baby. That room used to be the library, and the one beyond that used to be the parlor. Am I correct?
Yes. When Mr. Starkweather became too ill to go up and down the stairs, the library was converted into a room for Mr. Starkweather, and Withers took the parlor. Why do you ask?
Oh, no reason. I'm just curious.
Excuse me, folks. I thought that little bit of dialogue was a little awkward. Suggested to Mr. St. John he remove it, but he said he felt you needed to know the layout of the house. He said, what am I supposed to do? Put a blueprint of Starkweather Mansion in the program? Which, frankly, I thought was a little rude. But anyway, I wanted to remove it, but he insisted, so we kept it in. But I realize it's a bad piece of writing, and I tried to correct it and wanted to let you know. Carry on.
If you do that one more time, you're going to have to come up on the stage and play Mrs. Trent yourself.
Sorry.
That was great. I wish I had your nerve. Where are we?
So you're curious about the layout of the house, are you?
Oh, right. I'm just curious.
Well, you know what they say. Curiosity killed the cat.
Excuse me.
Good night. Wouldn't it be ironic if someone did break in tonight of all nights? And...
Mrs. Starkweather?
Oh, Bensonhurst! Oh, you nearly frightened me to death.
My apologies. Might I ask what pills you've just strewn about the room?
Oh, digitalis, for my heart. I have a heart condition. Maybe I should take two.
Well, perhaps the single dosage should be sufficient. After all, an overdosage could give you a heart attack.
Why, yes. Yes, it could. It could be extremely fatal. Or am I being redundant? I suppose fatal is fatal, just like dead is dead. Don't you agree?
Oh, yes, completely. One could not be deader than someone else. Dead longer, perhaps. But that's the only comparison that comes to mind.
Yes. Oh. Why, I'd better pick all these pills up.
Oh, allow me to assist you.
Oh, Bensonhurst, before we do that, can I ask you something?
Oh, of course, yes.
But what are you doing with the wrench?
A wrench?
Yes.
Well, you see, I overheard Miss Withers talking about a loose valve on the gas heater in Mr. Starkweather's bedroom, so I thought I ought to go in there and give it a turn or two.
Oh, how mechanical of you. We wouldn't want any of that gas to leak into his room, now would we?
Naturally not. But first things first, shall we?
Yes, yes. I just feel like a pigeon pecking popcorn, don't you?
You've missed one right by your left kneecap.
Where?
Your left
kneecap. I don't have my glasses. I don't see it.
Yes, round objects do tend to do that.
Oh, Nurse Withers!
Oh, Miss Starkweather. What were you doing on the floor with Bensonhurst?
Oh, we were just picking up my pills. I spilled them.
Has Mr. Starkweather required an injection? Is there any problem?
Nothing I can't handle. Seemed to be somewhat congested, so I took him back from his bed and sat him up in his wheelchair. He can breathe easier in an upright position. Then I gave him this injection of steroids to help open up his bronchial passages.
Oh my, where would Uncle Simon be without you?
Dead.
Oh.
Without my help, your uncle's heart would have stopped beating long ago.
Speaking of which, isn't there something that you'd like to ask, Miss Withers?
Was there?
The digitalis.
Oh, yes, Miss Withers, I was going to ask you if you had any free manufacturer sample of digitalis you don't need. I have a heart condition and I'd like to keep a supply handy.
Oh, Miss Starkweather, yours seem to run out, don't they? Well, I'm sorry, but I'm fresh out of spare drugs. Your uncle requires everyone he's got to keep him going.
Okay. Do you think you could help us pick up mine then?
I suppose.
Thank you.
Well, is this a private game or can anyone play?
Oh, Mr. Davis, we're picking up spilled pills.
Oh, is that it? I thought you were holding a marble tournament. I'll pass.
Well, if you'll excuse me, I really must return to my duties.
Thank you.
Miss Withers, how is the boss?
Bossy. He sent me for a pitcher of fresh drinking water, and if I'm not back in a minute, he'll start ringing that bell for me. Oh, you see what I mean? I'm coming, Mr. Starkweather.
I gather he rings for you a lot?
Oh, incessantly. When he stops ringing that bell, I'll know he's kicked the bucket.
Spoken like a true member of the medical profession. What's with the wrench, Bensonhurst? You got a problem I can give you a hand with?
No, thank you, sir. It will wait. I too have something. I too shall excuse myself.
Well?
You're up kind of late, Mrs. Starkweather.
Yes, I couldn't sleep. What about you, Mr. Davis?
Oh, I'm a real night owl. Besides, I was hoping young Simon Starkweather would show up. I haven't met him yet.
Oh, Simon's a sweet boy. Oh, I do hope he's okay with the storm and all.
Yeah, well, he may have pulled off to the side of the road to let it pass. It looks like it's starting to cloud over again. We could be in for another deluge.
Oh, I certainly hope not. I better go in my room and lie down for a bit. Good night.
Good night, Mrs. Starkweather.
Get out of my way. I'm coming, Mr. Starkweather.
Oh, you're still here.
Just keeping an eye on things.
I see. Well, my patient. I'm coming!
You're up to, Mr. Davis?
Yeah, and I'm not the only one. There seems to be more traffic going through Starkweather Mansion at midnight than goes down the interstate during rush hour.
I know what you mean. I've been hearing footsteps go past my door all evening. It's no surprise, though. You could have guessed that Mr. Starkweather's announcement would give his heirs a sleepless night or two.
Between us, Miss Van Zandt, this cloning business, how do you feel about it?
I'm a lawyer, Mr. Davis. I'm paid to think, not to feel. Can I be cloned? No. Can he be cloned? Yes. Now, should he be cloned? That's another question entirely. And let's just say I wouldn't want to be the first to challenge nature by creating another Lois Van Zandt.
Me too. I'm a simple guy. I've got enough to deal with in one lifetime. The sooner we can get this signing of the will over with and I can get back to the real world, the better.
The new will's ready. He can sign it first thing tomorrow morning.
The old boy's still awake. That nurse was in here a minute ago. I heard him ringing his bell for her.
Then there's no reason he can't sign it right now.
That's exactly what I'm thinking. The people in this house are as tense as a bunch of long-tailed cats and a room full of rocking chairs. I know I'm gonna feel better once the boss's plan is a done deal.
I'll go get the new will from my room. You let Mr. Starkweather know.
All right.
What in the world?
The circuit breaker must have tripped.
But the storm passed hours ago.
I know. I do not like this. I don't like this at all. I'm going to find Bensonhurst and have him show me where the main breaker is.
Good idea. I'll let Mr. Starkweather know we're taking care of it. Mr. Starkweather, everything's fine. Mr. Starkweather?
Hello? Is anybody in here? Miss Tent? Bensonhurst? Anybody?
Kathy, I know there's something wrong with Mr. Starkweather.
Oh,
and
no.
I can't find that nurse.
He hasn't signed the new will yet, has he?
No, but perhaps he's just fainted. We need light. Mr. Davis is trying to get the lights on.
It's Mr. Starkweather. Help him.
Somebody struck me.
What's going on?
Oh, my goodness.
Jordan?
Oh. I heard a scream.
He's dead.
Someone put the blood pressure cuff around his neck and pumped it up to maximum. 300 millimeters of mercury. Mr. Starkweather has been strangled to death.
Such a thing.
Give me a break. I'd say you and everyone else in this room are right up there on the top 10 list.
I've never seen this man before in my life.
Those drops on his robe, is that blood?
I'm not sure.
What else could it be?
Ma'am, I'll handle it. I'm the detective, remember? What can you tell us, Miss Withers?
Well, I went and brought him his pitcher of water. And I made sure he was breathing all right, but then I got a bit tired, so I went and laid down across my bed. The next thing I knew, the lights were out.
I noticed that too.
Hush!
But I did.
Anyways. Then Mr. Starkweather started ringing that bell for me, so I went to light a candle, and then somebody struck me in the head. I must have blacked out. The next thing I knew, the lights were on.
Yeah, we can take it from there.
You seem to be in charge, Mr. Davis. What do we do now?
We keep trying the phone so we can get through to the cops. If the lines are not up by morning, someone's gonna have to drive into town and report that there's been a murder at Starkweather Mansion.
What?
A murder?
murder?
Well, maybe. Yeah. I got an idea. Maybe, little hat, this man did himself in it. Or maybe not. That's disgusting. Oh, young Mr. Simon, you made it. What? And boy, do we have a surprise for you.
Wasn't that the most diabolical murder you ever saw? Don't you just love it? The way Mr. St. John's mind works, it's no wonder he went bonkers. Well, anyway, remember, during intermission, fill out your ballot with which character you think is the murderer and put it in the ballot boxes, or you can give it to an usher if you have to go to get a drink of water or something. Anyway, we'll see you in 15 minutes. Wait, wait, turn the lights back up. Sorry, folks, I was just working with the cast and making sure they were comfortable now that they know who the murderer will be for tonight's performance. There were certain things that Mr. St. John was putting in for the second act once he decided on the murderer, lines and actions that would be clues to the killer's identity. I just wanted to let you know so you can continue to play armchair detective and try to determine who the culprit is. So, having said that, relax and enjoy the conclusion of Murders in the Heir.
Dead? I can't believe Grandfather is dead.
Well, he is, Cousin Simon. And he's the deadest person I ever saw.
Oh, funny you should say that, Paula. Bensonhurst and I were discussing the degrees
Mother,
of death
Mother, please.
Earlier, and we were...
Mother.
Okay.
And he was murdered?
There's no doubt about it, kid. You saw the body.
Poor Grandfather. And to think, if I'd only gotten here a little bit sooner...
Wait. How do we know you didn't get here sooner?
What?
For all we know, you could have arrived hours ago, parked your car out of sight, slipped into the house and killed the lights moments before you murdered Simon Starkweather.
That's ridiculous. Why would I kill him?
I'd say a third of a $50 billion fortune is a pretty good reason to knock somebody off.
But I didn't know about this new will, and I wasn't here when Grandfather revealed that crazy cloning scheme you told me
it
about.
It would have been easy enough to hide right outside those French doors and eavesdrop on the conversation.
Why would I hide here? I was expected. Besides, I told you what happened.
Tell me again.
All right. So I was driving my car down that long country road, you know, the one that comes in from town? The wind was lashing the windshield so hard I could barely see. The wind? It was ripping branches off trees and throwing them against the car. It was almost like driving through a hurricane. And I managed to make it to the bridge.
Oh,
the
bridge! We can play bridge!
Yeah.
Bridge!
No,
I'm talking.
No bridge. No.
No bridge. No bridge. No bridge.
Sorry, cousins. It's fine. I managed to make it to the wooden piece of, you know, structure that goes across the stream. And the stream had risen up and torn it to pieces. There was no way I could cross it. But I remember there had been a tree about a mile down that had fallen down years ago. I used to play on it when I was a kid. I managed to make my way to the tree and get across it, and apparently I arrived just after Grandfather was murdered.
It's a good story, but it sounds way too rehearsed.
It's the truth, I swear it.
Maybe so, but I'm still not crossing you off my suspect list.
Speaking of, who do you have on that suspect list?
Everybody, except Miss Van Zandt and Kathy Collins. They both had a heck of a lot to gain if your grandfather had only lived a couple more minutes. As it turns out, they're both left out in the cold.
Especially me. Lois has other clients, but now I'm among the unemployed. I don't know what to do.
I'm sure once the estate has been settled, we can arrange for you to get a generous severance check.
take it out of your portion if you'd like, Cousin Simon. But Mother and I will pass.
Yes, yeah, so will I. Nothing personal, of course.
Of course.
What do we do now?
You know, Simon's story reminded me. We could play bridge. You would like to play bridge?
The way I see it, we sit tight until daybreak. Then I'll have you show me the way to your car and drive me into town. I'll report what I know to the police and notify them that the bridge is out.
Bridge, bridge.
My guess is that the cops will fly in by helicopter. They'll need to take the body to the coroner's office, examine the crime scene, and then take your statements. Once a homicide detective is assigned to this case, I'm out of here.
Wait, but you're a detective too. And besides, you were literally here when the murder occurred.
Maybe so, but now that Mr. Starkweather's dead, I'm off the payroll. My part's over.
I'll hire you to stay. I can't pay you until I get my portion of the inheritance, but if you're willing to wait...
You're on, kid. I figure you're good for the money. Incidentally, that offer dropped you down to the bottom of my suspect list. Might as well start making money.
How can we help, Mr. Davis?
First, I need to know as to everyone's whereabouts when Mr. Starkweather was murdered.
Establish everyone's alibis.
Yeah. Also, I'm going to need to know anything that you and the staff may have seen or heard during the last few hours that might lead us to the killer's identity.
Clues.
You got it. Clues, motives, and alibis. These are the things a detective has to work with. The motives in this case are obvious. The other elements aren't yet. They will be, though, by the time I'm finished.
Sounds like a good plan. Who do you want to start with, Mr. Davis?
Well, since you're paying the freight, you can call me Mike. How about you, Miss Thompson? Do you mind going first?
Well, I'd love to, but I'm awfully tired, and I just don't want
Paula,
to.
Paula, you don't have to, all right?
Well, what do you mean, dear?
I mean, this mustacheless man isn't a police officer. Have to tell him the time of day.
Well, that may be true, Cousin Jordan. Why would you refuse to cooperate unless you had something to hide?
Now look here, Simon. Don't start accusing me of murder unless you can prove it.
Simon's got a point. Do you really want me to tell the cops that everyone cooperated except the man with the mustache?
Well, Mike, you and I both know real police officers would find that hard to believe. And fine, I'll answer your dumb questions. But first, I'm going to take Mother upstairs and have her lie down. Why, she's getting up in her years and she needs her rest.
Oh, why, thank you, Jordan. I'm not a spring chicken anymore. But I'm not Miss Methuselah either.
Well, don't get excited, Mother. Are you all right? Do you need your digitalis?
No, I'm fine. Oh, but if I did, there's probably one or two around here. I dropped my pill bottle earlier.
All right, Mother, all right. Come on.
Okay.
You can call for us when you're ready.
I presume you want to question everyone in private? Kathy, you can wait with me in my room. I'd like to go over the old will again, as it will remain the official one.
Sure, Lois. Excuse us.
Mike, I'd like to stay here. Since I wasn't here when the murder occurred, hearing everyone's testimonies might give me a clearer picture of what happened here tonight.
Well, you're the boss now. I'm particularly interested in what happened between the time Mr. Starkweather announced he was changing his will and the time we discovered his body.
How long was that?
It was several hours. Well, Miss Thompson, did you notice anything suspicious earlier tonight before Mr. Starkweather was murdered?
Well, I was very disappointed by Great Uncle Simon's announcement, as you might well imagine. I mean, I can understand why you might want to clone someone like Leonardo DiCaprio, for instance, but Great Uncle Simon is not a very nice man. No offense, cousin. Anyways, I spent most of that time in my room, but I did come downstairs once on a little errand. I was outside the living room. I heard Minerva and that cute little maid Nancy talking.
So for dinner, I suggest we make my grandmama's most famous recipe of her duck breast. It is delicious. Nancy! What's the matter with you? Did you leave your mind in that other room? You haven't heard a single word I have said to you.
Well, a little bit is because of your accent, but...
Well, I can't control that.
I'm just so confused.
About what? Has that no good Skip Jordan been bothering you again?
Jordan? I mean Mr. Starkweather? What makes you think that?
Well, when I walked in on the two of you in the living room, you were standing mighty close together. Real, how do you Americans say it? Lovey-dovey-like. What did he say to you?
Well, I think he wanted me to
do something you didn't want to do?
Well, yes. But it's not what you're thinking.
Deji Parry! You know, if that boy tries anything, I will cut him down to size!
Minerva, no! He's not interested in me. I heard him with Miss Collins.
I get the picture now. When you lost your million, he lost interest in you, didn't he? He's following the money right to that Collins girl.
He proposed to her. But then she laughed at him.
Serves him right, that lazy bum.
Don't call him that.
Oh, Nancy, you are hung up on him, aren't you? You mustn't be fooled, my dear. That boy, he would just use you and then toss you aside like a wilted cabbage leaf. I've seen him do it to dozens of other girls just like you. Dozens.
Oh. Well, maybe he's ready to settle down now. If Mr. Starkweather hadn't changed his will, Jordan would be free to...
Free to do what?
Nothing. Now, if we're all finished, I'd like to go to my room now.
Go on, then. Nancy.
Yes?
Lock your door.
Excuse me, folks. That scene was a flashback. The other characters' stories, well, portions of them, will also be shown in flashback. Isn't that brilliant? Yes, well, anyway, I just wanted to make sure you got that. Carry on.
We will, thanks.
Yeah.
That man is really asking for it.
So, tell me, Mrs. Trent. Earlier tonight, did you happen to see anything suspicious?
Suspicious? I suppose you'd call toting a gun around the house suspicious, even though Mr. Starkweather was shot to death.
A gun? Who has a gun?
Someone has a gun besides me?
Paula Thompson, that's who. Claimed she's a regular Annie Oakley, and she mentioned how easy it would be for someone to walk through those French doors and kill Mr. Starkweather.
Did she now?
Ask her yourself.
Is there anything else?
I did happen to overhear a rather odd conversation between Rufus and Mrs. Starkweather. I was walking upstairs to distribute the candles in case of a power outage, which became useful, as you know, when I saw Mrs. Starkweather at the far end.
Miss Starkweather!
Rufus! Oh, you nearly scared a year's growth out of me.
Well, that's okay, ma'am. At our age, we do all our growing sideways, don't we?
Oh, I certainly hope not. Oh, well, what are you doing with the television set? That doesn't look portable.
It is now. I'm borrowing it from one of the guest rooms that ain't in use.
Oh, yeah?
Well, you see, it's like this, ma'am. I wasn't too sleepy, so I thought I'd watch me some TV. But the color on my set in my room, well, it's all messed up. Everybody on every dadblamp channel is green. Dexter, well, they're all green. Prison Break, you know when I break out of prison? Well, they're all green. How to Get Away with Murder, everybody's green. It looks like every station is starring Kermit the Frog.
Oh, how disconcerting.
Well, you can say that again, ma'am, whatever the heck it means.
Well, how disconcerting.
You said, you actually said it again, but. Well, say, them breath mints, I sure could use a few. I can still taste that kraut Minerva served the staff for supper. You know, she's from Russia.
I do know that, but Rufus, no, these are not breath mints. Well, these are for my heart. If you took any of these pills, why, they could kill you.
Oh, well, in that case, I'll pass, ma'am. Well, you better be careful not to leave them lying around, though. Someone could eat a bunch by mistake and keel over dead.
Well, that is entirely possible, yes.
What would you put on their death certificate? Cause of death, bad breath.
No. That's not funny.
I thought it was.
I'll be careful with these pills, you see? I need every last one of them. Every last one of them.
An axe in the house?
Yes, I had ordered him to chop some firewood earlier.
I'm very surprised you trust that man with an axe.
Personally, I wouldn't trust him with a spoon. But I was simply relaying Master Simon's orders.
Was there anything else of interest you happened to notice?
Just one thing. Earlier tonight, I saw Master Jordan standing outside of Mr. Starkweather's door. His behavior was quite furtive. It appeared as though he was about to enter when Minerva came out. And it was clear that Minerva's unexpected arrival had startled Master Jordan.
Well, what do you want?
Oh, I'm sorry, Miss Withers. I was just coming to check on Great Uncle Simon.
No need. That's what I'm paid to do.
Well, how is he?
Still breathing. That's what you're wondering about.
But do you think he'll make it through the night?
I think your great uncle will keep his heart beating out of sheer determination long enough to sign that new will. That is what you're wondering about, isn't it?
Why? You misjudge me, Miss Withers. All I was trying to...
Oh, give it a rest, Jordan. You'd love to see him drop dead before daybreak, just like nearly everyone else in this house.
Including you. $1 million is a fortune. And a lot of people would kill for that much money.
If that's a hint, forget it. As Mr. Starkweather's nurse... I'd be the prime suspect if his death appeared to be anything but by natural causes.
But you've got to remember, suspecting and proving are two very different things.
I'm gonna forget you said that. Good night, Jordan. Yes, it's true. Jordan Starkweather did hint that I'd be in a position to end his great uncle's life in a way that appeared to be natural. But I also assume Bensonhurst told you that I refused?
He did, but you could have changed your mind.
And what, killed him with a blood pressure cuff? That would have been foolish.
I agree. The manner in which Mr. Starkweather was murdered makes no sense at all, whoever did it.
It's almost as if the murderer is flaunting the deed in our faces.
Why would they do that?
That's a good question, Miss Withers. Answer me this. If you had to choose a likely suspect, who would it be?
Off the record?
Sure.
That Paula Thompson is a little too goody-goody for my taste. Oh, sure, those summer girls can pour on to charm when they want to. But you know what? Scarlett O'Hara was pretty darn ruthless when you get down to it.
We've been told Cousin Paula has a gun.
You see what I mean? I dare say she and Jordan were desperate to get their hands on Mr. Starkweather's billions. I overheard them talking earlier this evening. It was right after Miss Van Zant made the whole announcement about the new will. They didn't see me in the corridor.
Well, what are we gonna do?
Do? What can we do? It's out of our hands.
Oh, don't be such a wimp, Cousin Jordan. That money is rightfully ours. There's gotta be a way to get it.
I know. Maybe we can break the will if we have Great Uncle Simon declared insane.
Shh. Nope. That won't work. I've already thought it through. If cloning were just a wild theory, it might could, but it's been done. His plan to be the first person to clone himself may be bizarre, but it sure as heck ain't insane. We'd lose the case.
Yeah, and probably spend the pittance we're going to inherit on the lawyers.
Like that Miss Van Zant. Jeez.
What is it? What are you thinking?
I'm thinking, if you can't beat him, join him.
What?
I just came up with a way to let Miss Van Zant put me on her team.
Well, awesome. What is it?
Fend for yourself, Jordan. Now, if you'll excuse me, I need to talk to that lawyer.
Paula! If you can't beat him. Oh, yeah. Now, where would that Kathy be?
Jordan did suggest we get married, but it wasn't what you'd call a romantic proposal. It was more of a business proposition.
You were going to have access to billions. What did Jordan have to offer you?
Himself, I guess. But if you ask me, that fortune hunter isn't worth 2 cents.
So you did turn him down then?
Mike. Jordan is attracted in a playboy kind of way, but any girl to marry him would be a fool. And believe me, Mike, I'm no fool.
I knew that from the time we started working together.
You were smart enough to volunteer to carry grandfather's clone.
Simon, honey, when your grandfather decided to clone himself, nothing was gonna change his mind. He was gonna find some bimbo off the street to do it anyway, so it may as well have been me.
I know, it's just the whole idea is a little creepy.
You're a lot nicer about it than some of the other heirs were.
For example?
Paula! That girl hadn't given up hope on getting their money on Mr. Starkweather's billions.
How do you know?
Well, I was in Lois's room when she came in and asked if they could talk in private. I couldn't help but overhear their conversation.
We're very busy, Miss Thompson. Are you preparing that new will?
Yes. Miss Van Zant, you're a lawyer.
Yeah.
Are you sure this whole cloning business is legal? I mean, you could lose your license to practice, couldn't you?
As we already told you, the process is going to be performed in Belgium. Our laws don't apply there.
What about ethics? Haven't lawyers been disbarred before for behavior that was unethical, if not illegal?
What's your point?
I want in on the deal. You can pay me from that trust fund to be the baby's nanny or whatever. I really don't care what you call the position. If you refuse, however, I shall be forced to report you to the Bar Association. Ain't that what you call it?
It is. Let me give you a little free legal advice, Miss Thompson. Mm-hmm. First, if you make any accusations towards me or Kathy before the cloning procedure has been completed successfully, I'll sue you for the $50,000 you're due and everything else you owe. And I'll get it. Second, after Little Simon's on the way, I plan to close down my practice and devote all my time to Kathy and Little Simon's care. Shouldn't bother me in the least if I should be disbarred then. It doesn't take a lawyer to administer an estate. Anyone can do it.
Oh,
yeah. So you see, your threats are meaningless. And as an officer of the court, I should really report your feeble attempt at extortion to the police.
Well, I didn't
save it. Take your silly southern self out of my sight, and I might be willing to forget it.
Did you really just go there?
Mm-hmm. All right, then. I'll go. You lawyer.
Excuse me.
Yes, Miss Trent?
I found what's left of the Christmas candles I had stored away. I suggest you keep one and some matches nearby in case of a power failure.
Thank you. I'll take one to Kathy. She's in my room.
Miss Thompson?
Fine. I need to go to my room. There's something I need to get.
What's her problem?
Let's just say she's a poor loser. Miss Thompson played her ace and I trumped it, in a manner of speaking. I'll give this to Kathy.
If I remember correctly, when Kathy Collins saw Mr. Starkweather's body and screamed, you ran in through the front door. What had you been doing outside, Rufus?
Was I outside? Oh, I guess I was. Yes. Oh, I know. I had borrowed a TV from the guest room because...
Wait, we heard why.
Well, you did? News sure travels fast around here.
All the characters on your set were green.
Well, they sure were. It looked like the Martians had landed or something. Anyways, when I put the new TV, when I'd hooked it up, the picture didn't come in too good. Everybody was fuzzy as a woolly worm. Funny, really. Anyways, I'd gone outside to turn the antenna around.
On the roof?
On the roof, this guy. Well, it won't do much good in the basement now, would it? And they tell me I'm not too sharp. Well, yeah, on the roof. I had gone to get the tall ladder out of the shed when I'd heard a gal holler bloody murder. Well, murder anyways, even if it wasn't bloody.
When you were outside, did you hear anyone talking about the new will?
Oh,
or
sure.
Did you, let me rephrase that. Did you see or hear anything at all when you were outside?
Oh, of course I did. I heard a bunch of bullfrogs. I heard an owl.
Good gosh, Rufus, I meant humans.
Why didn't you say that? Well, I saw Mr. Jordan on the porch. Not sure what he was doing out there, but he was out there.
Did you hear anybody talking about the new will?
Well, who didn't? Old Bensonhurst and the Minerva didn't talk about much else. They was going on and on about it in the kitchen before Mr. Starkweather croaked.
What were they saying?
Well, that it ain't fair. That's what they were saying. But they worked hard for Mr. Starkweather all these years. Well, me, I mean, I didn't care too much. I figured $50,000 would buy me a new TV with a big old screen. I guess now I might even get me two. Two of them right side by side.
So it was Bensonhurst and Minerva?
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. The more they talked about it, the madder she got. That woman has got a temper. You know, she's Russian. She was about to go into Mr. Starkweather's bedroom and give him a piece of her mind.
You mustn't go in there, Minerva.
Oh, really? Who is going to stop me?
I shall, if necessary.
Oh, really? Really? You and whose army?
Minerva, I agree with you that we were wronged, but
Confrontation is not the answer.
Oh, really? Then what is?
Have patience. Perhaps Mr. Starkweather will change his mind by morning.
Oh, and we should live so long.
No, Minerva. He should live so long.
What had you been doing outside about the time of the murder, Mr. Starkweather?
Just getting a breath of fresh air. Anything wrong with that?
Not if you remained outside.
What is that supposed to mean?
When I made a cursory examination of the crime scene, I noticed that Miss Withers had left the window raised a couple of inches to let in some of that fresh air. Anyone could have come in through the window and...
Are you accusing me of killing Great Uncle Simon?
Calm down. I'm not accusing anyone of anything yet.
Besides, from what we've seen, it's more your style to trick someone else into doing your bidding.
Well, who told you that?
I'll ask the questions if you don't mind. Let's try this again, Jordan. What were you doing outside?
If you must know, Kathy and I had a little disagreement. I blew up. I went outside to blow off some steam, or have you already heard about that as well?
I question, you answer, remember? Let me ask you this. If you didn't murder Mr. Starkweather, who do you think did?
Now look, I'm not saying she did it, but have you talked to that little maid, Nancy?
Why her, Cousin Jordan?
Gentlemen, I flirt with a lot of ladies. A lot of ladies. But I did absolutely nothing to lead her on. I knew she was upset about the new will, and not just that she would lose her money, but that I would lose even more. I had strolled around the house and was outside of the kitchen when I heard Nancy talking to Miss Withers.
Can I help you with something,
Nancy?
Ms. Withers?
God. No, I'm just bringing some water to Mr. Starkweather.
Oh, that poor man. When he had that attack and lost breath in the living room, I knew exactly what you meant when you said that the slightest shock could prove to be fatal.
Exactly.
Oh, you've kept him waiting for quite some time now.
Yes, I must go.
Oh, what if we wouldn't want anything to happen to him? Now, would we? Oh, I was shocked to hear that Mr. Starkweather had included me in his will. I didn't even think that he noticed me.
Then you must have received two surprises. To hear that you'd inherit $1 million and then immediately discover that it was going to be taken away.
Three, actually. Now you're wealthy again.
Oh, I was thrilled to be told that your grandfather would be leaving me even $50,000. With that, I could go to college like you and get a good education.
Well, now you can do whatever you want. What do you want to do, Nancy?
Oh, well, I don't know. I haven't been thinking about myself much recently.
Well, who have you been thinking of? Jordan Starkweather, perhaps? You're very fond of him now, aren't you?
Who told you that?
Cousin Jordan himself, for one. He even made it out as if you'd be willing to kill for him.
He what? How could he say such a thing? Thank you.
I'm sorry, but now you see what Cousin Jordan's really like. He's out for himself, and he'll trample anyone who gets in his way.
Well, I guess I knew that.
Trevor tried to warn me, but... And I even heard him propose to Miss Collins. I was taking fresh towels to the guest rooms earlier when I heard them talking. You think that Jordan is cold-hearted? Well, Miss Van Zandt is just as bad as he is.
Can you believe it? Those soulful gazes might work on that young thing, Nancy, but Jordan learned quick enough with me that I'm no pushover.
I wish I could have been there to see it. It's time Jordan met his match. The stories I could tell Nancy about maids who worked here before her. The stories. His playboy days will soon be over, though.
Ooh, tea. Spell.
Well, up until now, Mr. Starkweather has given each of his heirs a very generous allowance. But after he passes on and his fortune falls in our laps, the $50,000 bequests will be the last they see of the Starkweather fortune. They'll have to learn what it's like to work for a living.
This bunch of fools? Oh, my goodness. Simon, he'll be fine. He's out of college, but the others, they're hopeless. True. What are they going to do? I mean, can you imagine Paula behind the desk of a car rental agency?
Or Jordan driving cars out at the lot for customers?
He'll be picking up keys instead of picking up women. And what will Fiona do? Sell her heart pills?
Can I get you anything, Cousin Fiona? A glass of water?
Oh, no, dear, I'm fine. Oh, Mr. Davis, I just want you to know that my Jordan, he couldn't have done what was done to Great Uncle Simon. He was with me in my room all evening.
Mrs. Starkweather, you know that can't be true. Your son just told us himself that he went outside. And I saw you in here earlier with Bensonhurst and Miss Withers.
Oh, yes. Maybe it was last night he sat with me.
Maybe it was.
Now I know why Jessica Fletcher never believes any of the suspects on murder she wrote.
Focus on tonight, Mrs. Starkweather.
Okay. Yes.
Earlier tonight, did you notice anything suspicious?
Suspicious? Oh, I saw Uncle Simon with that thing around his neck. I call that suspicious.
Mr. Davis means before the murder, Cousin Fiona.
Before? Oh, well, let me think. No, I don't know if this is sort of the thing you mean, but... Well, I was walking past the living room, and I saw Mrs. Trent and Kathy, I think it was. They were talking in the living room, and, well, they were talking so loudly I couldn't help it over here.
Miss Trent, what are you doing in my purse?
I was picking up all the nail files you left around. I suppose you're very pleased with yourself, Miss Collins.
And why do you say that?
It all worked out just as you planned.
I don't know what you mean.
I think you do. I understand now why you've brought all those magazines from town and left them lying around when Mr. Starkweather could see them. You've done it for months.
What magazines?
Don't play dumb, Miss Collins. Those news magazines and scientific journals, I've seen them. I didn't realize it until tonight, but they all had one thing in common. Articles about cloning. I didn't realize it until tonight, but now it's obvious what you're doing. You planted the idea in Mr. Starkweather's head to clone himself.
So what if I did? There's no law against sharing ideas.
I'm sure your lawyer friend would say no since you're in this together. That doesn't make it right. I think what you're planning to do is hideous.
To be perfectly crystal, Miss Trent, I couldn't care less what you think. Now stay out of my stuff.
Starting to give orders already, are we? I'll leave, but remember one thing. You aren't the queen bee yet, and you won't be until Mr. Starkweather's name is on that dotted line. Assuming that ever happens. About Mrs. Trent's accusations that she had engineered the cloning business, possibly with my help. It appears that Mrs. Starkweather
portrayed their conversation accurately, which is something of a surprise.
Is it true that you and Kathy gave Grandfather the idea to clone himself?
I don't think that's really relevant to the case at hand, Simon. Even if we did, we weren't breaking any laws, were we, Mr. Davis?
No laws that I can think of.
Exactly. So shouldn't we focus on the law that was broken? I am referring to murder, of course.
You're right as usual, Miss Van Zandt.
I know.
Can you volunteer any information that might help us?
Well, at one point I went to go get a pot of coffee from Minerva. I figured Kathy and I would be up late writing the new will, and I figured the caffeine would do us some good. Minerva wasn't there, but Rufus was. His conversation with Fiona Starkweather was peculiar. Oh, good heavens! Oh! Rufus, what are you doing with that axe?
Well, I brought it in from the wood pile to clean it up, sharpen it up. I did a real good job. Want to see?
Oh, goodness, no. You can put that away.
I suppose I better, before it hurts somebody, or even kills somebody.
Well, that's a horrible thought.
I know it is. I get them sometimes. Do you?
I...
Well, say, I see you still got your poison pills.
Digitalis is not a poison, it's a stimulant.
Excuse me?
Yes.
Well, you had a lot more in that bottle the last time I saw you. Don't you tell me that you done tried to take a bunch and overdose. I think I can figure out how to do that mouth-to-mouth stuff.
No! Rufus, if you bring those lips any closer to me, I'll snatch that axe out of your hand and I'll chop them off. Yes.
Well, I'm sorry, ma'am. I was only trying to help.
Well, don't. I assure you, however, that I'm fine. I just say I spilled my pills earlier in the living room, and I wasn't able to find them all.
Well, you better hope Minerva don't find none, but she fixes Mr. Starkweather's meals, and she's mighty mad at him right now.
Oh, no, Rufus. What are you suggesting?
Nothing. Well, was there something you needed help with in the kitchen?
Well, I was going to see if Minerva had any of those delicious hors d'oeuvres left.
Well, I can help you look, ma'am.
I'm actually okay. I lost my appetite.
Mr. Starkweather eat? Was it the same food as everybody else ate?
Mr. Starkweather was on a very restricted diet. Low salt, low fat, no gluten, no fiber. Blah! He was so annoying to cook for. So I had to prepare his meal separately. Normal humans do not eat like that. What do you want to know about my food? Do you think there's something wrong with my cooking?
There's nothing wrong with your cooking, Minerva. The leg of lamb you served tonight was wonderful.
yes, of course. I have been told many times. I have terrific legs. So, what is the problem then?
Forget it. You told me everything I need to know.
Good. If you need me, I will be in kitchen. It is time for my nightly drink. What? It helps me sleep.
Any luck?
Well, it's all there all right, but I wish I had more. It could take weeks for the results to come in. If the new will is probated and the killer gets his or her identity before then, they could disappear for good. You can buy a new identity easily enough for $1 million or more. There's gotta be some way that I can nab the guilty party tonight.
I was hoping we'd learn more from the witnesses' testimonies.
I know. It seems like they were all so busy trying to make each other look guilty that they didn't reveal that much about themselves. Sometimes, even the slightest... Simon, move your feet.
What?
here, I think it's... Yes. What they were doing was so insignificant, I barely noticed it at the moment. Simon, I know who murdered your grandfather.
Who?
I'll tell you once everyone is in here. Go get Bensonhurst and have him... Have everyone come in here immediately.
Yes, sir.
Minerva sent me in here to see if you'd like another pot of coffee.
Never mind that. Go upstairs and tell everyone to come down here on the double.
Yes, sir.
Wait till the police chief sees what I found. What's going on? All right, everybody. Have a seat.
It's very late, Mr. Davis. We're very early, depending on how you look at it. Well, nobody else is gonna ask, I might as well. What'd you call us in here for?
It has been a long night, hasn't it? I'm sure you all are very tired. But I figured you all would rest much easier knowing who murdered Simon Starkweather.
You mean you've discovered who killed Great-Uncle Simon?
I believe I have, as I'll show you in the next few minutes.
I'm amazed, Mike. How did you figure it out?
First, I had to find the answer to a question that had bothered me from the beginning. It would have been so easy to make it appear that Mr. Starkweather died of natural causes. A suggestion Jordan Starkweather made to Miss Withers.
Now, wait a minute, Mike.
For example, Mrs. Starkweather or her son could have given him some of her digitalis to trigger a heart attack. So could several others among you who were aware that she had them and had left several on the floor of this room, no doubt, when she spilt them earlier tonight. Miss Withers could have injected an air bubble into his bloodstream with a hypodermic needle. But again, any of you could have stolen a needle from her room and done the exact same thing. Also, it's highly probable that some of you actually considered frightening the old man to death. Minerva with her knife, Miss Thompson with her gun, Rufus with his axe, Bensonhurst with his wrench. The possibilities are endless. Why then would the murderer choose to put a blood pressure cuff around his neck and inflate it until he was strangled to death? The answer is so obvious, I feel foolish for not realizing it sooner.
Might I ask what that is?
Obviously, when the blood pressure cuff was put around Mr. Starkweather's neck, he was already dead.
What?
What?
Am I right, Miss Van Zandt?
It's always the lawyers.
You really are very clever, Mr. Davis.
It had to have been you. We were in here together when the lights went out. Mr. Starkweather began to ring his bell for her. I went to find Bensonhurst, and you went to check on Mr. Starkweather, which means his killer must have slipped into the room and murdered the man seconds before you found the body.
That's what I figured, too.
But why would you put the cuff around his neck?
As our able detective here has surmised, the killer made it appear that Mr. Starkweather had died of natural causes. I knew this simply wasn't the case, but I also knew that under the circumstances, the coroner would have no reason to perform an autopsy, and the police wouldn't conduct an investigation. I simply couldn't let my employer's murderer get away scot-free. So I noticed the blood pressure cuff sitting on his bedside table. I simply put it around his neck and inflated it before wheeling him in here.
And your plan worked. No one would have questioned the fact that he had been murdered.
And then young Master Simon here hired Davis to find out who the killer is.
Which I have. That was very deceptive of you, Miss Van Zandt. For a while, your little ploy distracted me from the main problem. Because instead of focusing on who did it, I kept on wondering, why did they do it that way? Once I saw that piece of the puzzle, the rest came much, much easier.
Sorry, Mr. Davis, but if you've discovered the killer's identity, the ends seem to have justified the means.
Well, I imagine the police will agree with you. And they might even overlook the fact that you're guilty of tampering with evidence at the scene of a murder.
If not, I'm on very good terms with all the local judges.
Wait a minute. How do we know Miss Van Zandt didn't kill Great-Uncle Simon?
Yeah. No motive.
Well, don't keep us in suspense, Mike. Tell us who did kill Mr. Starkweather.
I'll do better than that. I'll show you. Bear with me. I suppose you all still have the candles that Mrs. Trent distributed earlier tonight in case of a blackout. Take them out, please.
Ooh, very Christmassy. Did
Jingle bells, jingle bells, jingle bells, jingle bells, snow.
When I examined Mr. Starkweather's body, I found what I first thought were a few drops of blood on his bathrobe. But on closer inspection, they turned out to be another substance entirely. I forgot about them for the moment. While I was interrogating you individually, I noticed one of you scraping one thumbnail against the other. At the time, I took it to be a nervous gesture. I guess you could say it was nerves triggered by guilt, as it turned out. A few minutes ago, I noticed these on the floor by the sofa, and I had what I needed to identify the murderer. Thin scrapings of red tallow. Tallow from the killer's thumbnail. Tallow that matched the red drops on Mr. Starkweather's body. Tallow from the red candle the killer was holding when they murdered Simon Starkweather. Tallow from the one red candle that Rufus is holding.
Well, there might have been other red candles.
No, 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 there weren't.
No, she's right. I remember when we took them down for Christmas, we'd have to buy more red ones for next year.
Dang it. What, was this all the evidence that you got? This little thing?
I got way better proof than that. I just examined Mr. Starkweather's body, Rufus. As I was moving about the room a few minutes ago, I glanced at everybody's hands, and I noticed that there are several very thin scratches on your wrist, made by Mr. Starkweather, no doubt, as he struggled for his life. I'll bet my reputation that the skin samples I was able to scrape out from underneath his fingernails came from you. And it'll be easy enough to prove. I've met quite a few experts in DNA these past 6 months.
Bravo, Mr. Davis. Bravo.
Well?
Well, I don't suppose you'd consider cloning them scrapings and putting a new me in prison.
Oh, perfect. Oh. Why would you do that?
Well, I didn't think so anyways. Dang it. Well, you lawyer, I guess I done messed up trying to cross you. Oh, you might have lost, Mr. Starkweather's billions. Oh, but you definitely got your revenge, lady.
Why don't you tell everybody what happened?
Well, I might as well anyways. You figured out the main things. I was mad at Mr. Starkweather for tempting us with all that money, then taking it back. Well, I thought a man that mean don't deserve to live. I waited outside his hall and went in his bedroom when I knew he was alone. He was sitting up in his chair, still awoke, of course. He was sitting there. I went up to him and grabbed the handles out of that wheelchair and looked right in the eyes. I told him that I thought he was a monster and don't deserve to live. I told him that I was going to kill him. Rufus Jones. I reached for his throat. He was scared. I'm talking real scared. But he looked like you. I reached for his throat, but it went back in his chair and it hit that little table beside his bed. Then the reading lamp and a pitcher of water fell. And then it got dark right quick, real dark.
So you didn't cause the blackout deliberately?
Well now, Tiny Hat, I don't know what blackout means because I don't use big words. But the darkness, what we all call it, nearly ruined everything. But I remember that I had one of them candles that Mr. Trent gave me in my pocket. So I pulled it out. I lit it with one hand, and I grabbed that dead-blamed oxygen mask with the other. I held it, mashed it over his face. Oh, he tried to fight back, but all he could manage was a couple of baby scratches. Like you noticed that, and he caused me to spill a little candle wax, not tallow, wax, on his robe. I don't know if he died from not breathing or heart attack, but it don't really matter because he was dead. The old man wasn't able to do much, but I guess it was just enough to pin his murder on me.
And then what happened, Rufus?
Well, then I went through the door to Miss Withers' room. Her back was facing me. I grabbed a brass candlestick, and I hit her over the head.
Oh, yeah!
She fell down, and her light went out. Then, I heard you, Miss Screamer, and I joined the rest of you in here.
You must have been as shocked as everybody else to see the blood pressure cuff around Mr. Starkweather's neck.
Well, of course I was. Oh, it was easy to figure what you'd done, briefcase. Oh, you were framing me for that murder I done did. Oh, man. Oh, man, I would have loved to have killed you, too. Oh, but I wouldn't dare try, of course. No, no, no. Until now.
Easy! You don't want to do anything you might regret.
Oh, I think it's a little late for that, Mr. Davis. You, get up. Give me a coffee.
Where can we go? The bridge is washed out.
Oh, yeah. Well, I know where that tree is that young Simon was talking about in his story. You, give me the keys.
You will not get away, Rufus.
Oh, I think I might. All your cars is on this side of the street. And the phone lines are still dead, as the screamer pointed out. Oh, it'll take you hours to notify the police. I'll be halfway to Mexico. Not Mexico. I ain't going to Mexico. I'm not. I'm going somewhere that I'm not going to say.
You monster!
And you, well, you're coming with me.
What?
Yeah.
What are you going to do to me?
Well, what do you think I'm going to do with you? I'd have committed the perfect murder if it wasn't for you, briefcase. I mean, what do you think I'm gonna do with you?
Nothing if I can help it.
No!
Hold it right there, Rufus!
Are you okay?
You got it.
I'm fine.
You got it.
Don't hit my nose.
This Lois doesn't need a Superman to save her.
Let's have him.
Mike, remind me to give you a big bonus.
No problem, kiddo. Well, you're gonna spend a long time behind bars. What do you have to say for yourself?
Well, for one thing, the TV situation in prison is gonna be a lot better than it was here.
Message from Mr. Culpepper. Message from Mr. Culpepper.
This letter just came for you.
Good.
It's urgent.
Sorry, I better check and see what this is about. It's from Mr. St. John. He says he just came to from a drug-induced coma. When he awoke, a fantastic solution to the play was crystal clear. Really? That's brilliant. This new ending is unbelievable. Huh. Better than any of the possible conclusions he came to before. You simply have to see it. It'll take a few minutes for me to go over it with the cast, but I'm sure they can handle it. I see some clues that need to go in the first act. I guess we'll have to do the whole play over again.